Amazing grace. Amazing grace. You know, as I listen to the testimonies of the preachers and brethren, one thing that we all have in common is we've all felt the pain that sin brings. But thank the Lord that for a group of us, story doesn't end there. You know, there's a lot of people in a graveyard or a cemetery tonight, and the sad truth is their life ended with the pain of sin. But thank God tonight for His grace and His mercy, His amazing grace. We felt the pain of sin, but we found where sin did abound, grace did much more abound. Grace did super and exceedingly abound, far past the pain of sin. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let's just give God praise tonight. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I thank the Lord very much for the opportunity to be here tonight and preach the gospel. I thank Brother Matt for having me, and Brother John and Brother Joey, all the pastors that are a part of it. I thank each and every one of you for coming out. Brother Mark, Brother Colton, beautiful singing, Brother Ballard, and everyone who was a part of it to put it on. God's truly doing something special. Amen. In this land. Amen. In these last days. And I'm thankful that He would include us. Amen. To be a part of it. Amen. A bunch of people who just a few years ago weren't even in the fight. Nowhere to be found.
Amen.
M.I.A.
Come on.
With the Holy Spirit of God. Drew us in. My name is Luke Pogue. I'm from a little town called Eupora, Mississippi. I drove about 360 miles to be here with you, and I thank the Lord just for that opportunity. I'm the associate pastor of a little church in Greenwood, Mississippi called Crossway Ministries. And our pastor, senior pastor, is Brother Wayne Boss. Very thankful for him. As Brother John said, we're a part of Crossline Radio, Crossline Television, CrosslineTV.com. You can look us up. I preach a message every morning at 7 o'clock. Brother John's there, Brother Mark Goldwire, many other preachers who, as they said, are narrow-minded, cross-eyed, centered on the cross of the Lord Jesus Christ. When we open these scriptures, I thank the Lord that He's revealed His Son and His cross in the scriptures. Otherwise, it's the letter that killeth. But if we can open the Word of God and see Jesus, see His cross, then we can see ourselves. Now the Word of God is applicable to our life. Now in spirit. And it is life. Amen. And I'm very thankful. You know, I'm humbled every time when I get an opportunity to preach, especially to a group of people who know the Lord and know this message. Is a great honor and a great privilege. And, you know, shortly after I was saved, the Lord began to deal with me about preaching. And I said, "No, Lord, you got the wrong man. Nobody's going to listen to me. I done messed up too bad, made a fool out of myself, went down too many wrong paths. Get you somebody that's a little cleaner than I am." But the Lord continued to deal with me about it. And one of the first stories that the Lord gave me an understanding of, I was raised in a Baptist church where they preached that Jesus is the Savior, and I'm thankful for that. But I didn't know how to live in victory. I was in and out of church and in and out of relationship with the Lord all my life. And finally, I got old enough and big enough out on my own, and I'm done with this mess. And I went my own way, and I was a mess. I lived my life running from God, and I didn't like to hear people talk about God. I believed that the Lord was real. I believed that heaven and hell was real, but that I wasn't too sure about where I was going. And I tried to follow the Lord when I was a young teenager, but I didn't know this message. I didn't know how to live in victory, and that's a hard place to be. You can't stay there. And so I turned and walked out on the Lord one day Lord allowed the things in my life to start crumbling down on top of me. I was on a tractor in North Mississippi, and the Lord began to break my heart because of who I was, what I was doing, what I had become. And he sent me to I was living in a camper at night. And I went home to that camper that night, and I felt like I had a ton of concrete on my back, and I fell in the floor of that camper trailer, and I repented to God. I confessed everything I could think of. I asked Him to save me, to forgive me, to cleanse me, and help me. And I walked out of that camper the next morning, and I knew I was free.
Hallelujah.
I wasn't an alcoholic anymore. I wasn't any kind of an addict. My heart had been changed, and I went home and told my wife about it. She didn't know what to think of me. Here we go again, but no, I knew this time it was different, but I felt like I left Egypt, but I knew Pharaoh's back there somewhere, and he's coming. He don't turn loose too easy, so I began to pray. I said, Lord, You got to give me some staying power. You got to give me something to hold on to. You got to give me some strength and some power. And it's not enough just to leave Egypt. We got to have provision for the journey to make it and to be in fellowship with God and have His power and grace flowing through our lives. So then the Lord sent me to Brother Swaggart's ministry and began to teach me the message of the cross. I got me an expositor study Bible. And one of the first things the Lord showed me is in Mark chapter 5. If you follow my preaching at all, I preach about this guy all the time. You remember when you first met the Lord and He began to show you some specific things in the Scripture. You're like a bulldog on a bone now. You ain't turning loose of it. Come hell or high water, that's the truth.
Yeah.
And I believe it. And I'm going to use this to get through. The Lord showed me about this guy. Is in the country of the Gadareans.
Yeah.
He's over there living in a graveyard. He cuts himself with rocks and stones. He's in the mountains day and night crying. Can't get no relief. They try fetters, chains, binders, everything to help him. There was no help. He's got a whole legion of demons inside of him. Well, Jesus showed up, and with just one word, the man is healed and delivered. They see him. The Bible said that he was seated. That means he's resting.
Amen.
He's resting in Jesus now.
Yes.
He's not plagued by those demons anymore, but he's rested. He's seated. He's clothed. It speaks of the righteousness of the Lord Jesus Christ. It has become his covering. His identity has been found in the righteousness of the Lord Jesus Christ. And the Bible says that he was in his right mind.
Yes.
The Bible tells us in 2 Timothy chapter 1 and verse 4, that when you were saved, God gave you a spirit of love and power and a sound mind. How many of you know that you were insane before you met Jesus? Out of your mind and insane before you met the Lord. But He gave you a sound mind. He put you in a state of right mind. And when all this is over, the man who's been delivered, he's saved now, and he wants to go with Jesus. But Jesus says, no, not right now. But I tell you what you do. Go back to your country. Tell your family and tell your friends what a great thing that the Lord has done for you and that He had compassion upon you. That's what I've been sent to do. Hallelujah. Didn't come to tell you all about me. I mess up and I fell down, but Jesus did a great thing for me. He had compassion on me when none other did, and He loved me and He saved me. And I want you to know tonight, it doesn't matter where you may be, what you're going through, what may be in the past is the past. Jesus wants to erase it and give you a future. Your daddy may have been an alcoholic and your mama a drug addict, but you don't have to be that.
Hallelujah.
You don't have to be that tonight. It doesn't matter what's been in the past. Jesus came and He shed His precious blood for the sin of the whole world. His blood can make the vilest sinner clean. And the Bible says that the Father was pleased with the sacrifice of His Son, so He recalled His Son up again from the dead. And today Jesus sits at the right hand of the Father. He ever lives to make intercession for us. He has all power and authority. It's been given unto Him and none other. He's been given a name that is above every name. And the good thing
faith.
Amen.
By grace through faith, we can lay a hold, lay a claim upon the Lord Jesus Christ by grace through faith.
Amen.
And the Bible says in Romans 10:17 that faith comes by hearing. Hearing comes by the Word of God.
Amen.
And by the grace of God tonight, that's what I want to do. I want to preach the Word of God.
Amen.
Now I believe it like this. When the Word of God is preached in the context of Christ and the cross, then faith is there. Faith can be established when the truth is proclaimed. Jesus said that when you know the truth, the truth will make you free. Not just set you free and let you run around a little while, but make you free to run the race. Run the race of this life. Hallelujah. When we can get an atmosphere like this,
hallelujah,
where people believe the same thing. Not these folks over here believe something else. These one thing. These folks over here not sure yet. No, we all believe the same thing. That's what true unity is.
Right.
It ain't that we just come together and have a multi-church meeting.
On,
true unity means that we all have believed upon the Lord Jesus Christ and the blood that He shed on Calvary's cross.
Hallelujah.
Coming together as one man. If you have your Bibles, turn to 2 Kings chapter 4. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
The Lord had laid this upon my heart. I've never preached from this passage of Scripture before, but I believe it'll be a blessing for us. As I said, we're going to look to find Jesus. We're going to find His cross. We're going to identify a problem. How many know that there's a problem in the land today? But if we can identify the problem, then we can find the cure.
Yes.
It's foolishness. And you know, the state of many Americans is to ignore the problem, thinking it'll go away. No, it won't go away. Identify it. Realize that God has an answer.
Yeah.
And God has a cure for our problem. 2 Kings chapter 4 and verse 38. It said, Elisha came again unto Gilgal, and there was a dearth in the land. And the sons of the prophets were sitting before him. And he said unto his servant, set on the great pot and seethe pottage for the sons of the prophets. And one went out into the field and gathered herbs and found a wild vine and gathered thereof wild gourds his whole lap full and came and shred them into the pot of pottage, for they knew them not. So they poured out for the men to eat, and it came to pass as they were eating of the pottage that they cried out and said, O man of God, there is death in the pot, and they could not eat thereof. But he said, then bring meal. And he cast it into the pot, and he said, pour out for the people that they may eat. And there was no harm in the pot. But tonight I want to preach a message entitled, Bring the Meal.
Amen.
Bring the Meal. Will you pray with me? Father, I thank you, Lord, for your word. I thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to preach the gospel. I thank you for the cross of Calvary, the blood of Jesus Christ that washes away every sin, that brings us into the family of God. I thank you, Lord, for Pentecost that equips a preacher and a teacher, Lord, to serve you. Lord, I ask God that you would lay me aside and your Holy Spirit, your anointing would come, Lord, now and anoint my mouth and my lips to speak your word. Lord, deal with the hearts of men and women and children in here tonight. Let this not be just another church service, Lord, but let us be edified, strengthened, and changed by the power and the glory of God. Do a great work, Lord, in these altars when we're through. We give you thanks and glory for it. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
And amen. Hallelujah. I want to begin to talk a little bit about Elijah and Elisha. If I get their names wrong, I'm sorry. Sometimes I get a little tongue-tied while I'm preaching.
Amen.
But Elisha followed Elijah. Elijah, I believe, is a type of the Lord Jesus Christ. And when Elisha was plowing field for his daddy in a yoke of oxen, one day Elijah comes by and tells Elisha, Elisha wants to go with him. He wants to follow him because he feels the anointing and the power of God that's on the man of God's life. And the Bible says that he thought about it a minute, but then he slew those oxen, made a sacrifice right there, and then he began pursuit of Elijah, the man of God. And all throughout the journey through the land, Elisha would be told by Elijah to go on back home. Go back where you... I'm going over there. You stay here. But Elisha, he's in relentless pursuit of the man of God. You're not leaving me anywhere. Elijah. Elijah's a type of great leadership.
Amen.
I thank the Lord that he's still got some Elijahs walking this earth today. Great leadership.
Hallelujah.
I thank the Lord that though it may be a small remnant, there is a standard.
Amen.
That's lifted up in this land. And I encourage you to surround yourself with good leadership.
Amen.
The Bible, the Lord set this up in creation that everything produces after its own kind. If you
Amen.
Put horses together, you get horses.
That's
if you put
right.
cattle, I'm a cowboy from Mississippi. If you
Amen.
Put a bull and a heifer together, you're going to get a calf. Amen. They won't produce anything else. You put a horse and a cow together, nothing will ever happen. But if you follow a ministry that's built upon the ideologies of man and the wisdom of man, that's what they're going to produce in you. But if you'll get in a place, though it may be ridiculed and despised by the world, though it may be small in number, but if you can find a place where the power of God is, the anointing of the Holy Ghost is, and the truth is preached in light of Christ and his cross, it'll produce life in you. It'll produce leadership. It'll produce freedom and liberty
yes.
in your heart and in your life. The Bible says in James chapter 1 and verse 19 and 20, and this is a prayer that I've made being a young preacher. I know that there ain't nothing worse than somebody young that knows everything. But the Bible says in James chapter 1, it says, let every man be slow to speak.
That's right.
Swift to hear.
That's right.
And slow to wrath. Because the wrath of man worketh not the righteousness
Amen.
Of God. And I said, Lord, when I get around these older ministers, these preachers,
Amen.
These Christians that have been serving you longer than I've been alive, help me to shut my mouth and be attentive to what they're saying
Amen.
And the wisdom that comes through their lips. You know, that'd be a good lesson for all of us to listen more than we talk and absorb the Word of God. Absorb the wisdom. Surround yourself with good leadership. And I see Elijah as a type of the Lord Jesus Christ. When Elijah was carried away in a whirlwind into heaven, when he was translated into glory, he left behind his mantle. I believe that mantle is a type of the Holy Spirit.
Yeah,
when Jesus left to go be with the Father, he left behind he sent back the Holy Spirit on the day of Pentecost. And Elisha picks up that mantle and he slaps the waters of the Jordan and he says, where is the Lord God of Elisha? And he goes to proceed through the town and the people saw the power and the anointing of the Holy Spirit upon the young man. Life. When Jesus was crucified, buried, and resurrected, and when he went back to the Father, he sent back the Holy Ghost, the Comforter. And when the disciples were filled with the Holy Spirit on the day of Pentecost, they began to preach the gospel everywhere that they went, and the power of God moved. And then when the religious people saw the disciples, they said, we perceive that these are unlearned and ignorant men.
Right.
But the Bible said that they took knowledge that they had been with Jesus. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. The Holy Ghost produces. It ain't just that he gives us to fall out and speak in a funny language.
Right.
If that's all it is, it ain't the Holy Ghost.
Right.
But the Holy Ghost produces the nature and the character of the Lord Jesus Christ
Amen.
In your heart and life. And Elisha, he followed Elijah. I mean, everywhere that he went.
Amen.
Because he wanted a double portion. He wanted what he had. I thank God that there's Elijahs.
Amen.
But I'm telling you something, that there's a younger generation of preachers coming up. And we need a double portion of what Elijah
is.
We need a desperate heart. Elisha is a desperate man. You ain't getting out of my sight. I ain't going home. Anywhere you go, I'm not staying here. I'm going with you. We need God to put a fire and a desire, a hunger, a thirst inside of our hearts that we will pursue the Lord Jesus Christ. Because our generation, I'm 24 years old for the most part, that I know there ain't too many 24-year-olds following Jesus tonight.
Amen.
Most of them are out there in that world.
Yes.
They've been baptized when they were a kid and been led to believe that everything's okay
with God, and they'll go to heaven when they die. But they're on drugs. They're drinking alcohol. They're listening to the worst music that you and I could ever imagine. They're sleeping with whosoever will. And it's going to take more than a nice sermon to reach them. It's going to take more than a church service with some pretty lights and rock and roll guitars. It's going to take a double portion. And the Bible says that God is a rewarder of those that diligently seek Him. I'm not talking about earning something from God, but I'll tell you, God's not giving nothing to lazy people. But those that hunger and thirst for righteousness, Jesus said that those people will be filled. We need a double portion. We need a hunger and a thirst for what God has so that salvation can come back to this land.
Amen.
He said that He came again unto Gilgal.
That's good, brother.
Gilgal.
Praise God.
It means a rolling wheel.
Yes.
Got its name in Joshua chapter 5 and verse 9. God said to Joshua, He said, "This day I have rolled away the reproach of Egypt off you. Therefore, unto this day, the name of the place is Gilgal." I thank the Lord that when you come out of Egypt, you get a new name.
Yeah.
God rolls away the reproach and gives you a new name. That's what God is about. Like I said a moment ago, it don't matter what's in the past. That's in the past right there. A tombstone, and the lid is shut tight. And if you cling to Christ and His cross, He ain't coming back up.
Yes.
Adam ain't coming back up. I love that song. Last time I was here, you sang that song. Praise the Lord. I thank God that that old man is dead. I thank God that we've got a new name. Gilgal, we can tell just from that story that it's a place where God was able to move mightily and give great victories to Joshua. Samuel was the judge in the land, the first man to stand in the office of the prophet. Samuel ruled as judge in Gilgal. And Saul, when Saul was anointed and king, and the Bible said that a new nature came upon Saul in the beginning. You remember that when Saul was doing right and seeking the Lord. All this happened in Gilgal.
Yes. Amen.
But the Bible says now that Elisha comes to Gilgal, there's a dearth in the land. What's a dearth? A dearth is a famine. There ain't nothing to eat. There ain't no water. It's dry. Those tumbleweeds like out in Texas, they're rolling by.
Amen.
A place where God was once moving mightily. Now there's a dearth. There's a famine in the land. And you know what it was? The reason that it had been reduced down was brought on by the sins of the people.
That's it.
I'll tell you something. If we get high-minded and haughty, you know what's going to happen?
Come on.
The Lord's going to jerk the rug out from under you.
That's right.
Not because He hates you, but because He loves you. I believe that God is desperately trying to bring America to its knees, to a place of repentance so righteousness can be restored in our land again. But for the most part, people are so high-minded and heady that they don't give God the time of day. Go to church a little bit on Sunday, mow the neighbor's grass. And as I said a moment ago, the testimony of the American church, when you ask them, are they saved? They say, I took care of that a long time ago.
Yeah.
That ain't something you take care of a long time ago. I believe in a born-again experience that might have taken place a long time ago. But the only evidence that we have that we ever met the Lord is that we're still walking with Him tonight. When you meet one, it's so wonderful and marvelous. You don't trade Him in a couple of years down the road. But you follow Him.
Yes, Lord.
You follow Him. That's what the Lord's trying to do. A couple of Christians that I know, one a great preacher, one a great worship leader, they both testified that the Lord gave them a vision that they were standing upon a heap of rubble, plowed up concrete, buildings been toppled over and crashed down. But on top of the rubble are the remnant, the children of God, though small in number, they're up there preaching the gospel. And as they preach, here come the crowds. They're ready to listen now. They've been brought low, and they've been brought humbled. I believe that God is going to humble America. I believe that God is going to send a great shaking. And you tell you what, brother John, when that shaking comes,
hallelujah,
there won't be an empty seat. to the Crossway Ministry. There won't be an empty seat in this house. Keep preaching the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. Right now they're preoccupied, but there's soon to come a day when God will humble this nation. And I believe that the people, not everybody, but some are going to come. Some are going to come listen. Some are going to come hear it. Amen. Some's going to hear a famine has come. And the Bible says that the sons of the prophets sent before Elijah. You know, I didn't think a prophet was supposed to go through a famine. I didn't make it rain. That's what Elijah did. He shut it up for 4 years. Then he prayed to God and God turned it back on.
Amen.
But now, the sons of the prophets are sitting in famine. There ain't nothing to eat. Why are they there? You know, Elisha could have been upset with the prophets. But as I said, I believe this man is a type of the Lord Jesus Christ. He doesn't condemn the prophets.
Amen.
But instead he comes to them because he has compassion. Because he has love. For the prophets, he has love for the people. They're sitting at his feet absorbing the word of God. Why do you and I, when we know this message, we know God's plan of victory, why do we get in some of the situations that we get in sometimes? We don't have no excuse for it, but thank God that he don't kick us, give us the right foot of fellowship, but instead he has compassion on us. It's best to be sitting at the feet of Jesus. Oh, it doesn't matter what happens in this nation. Let's just sit at the feet of Jesus.
Amen.
And they'll be, we ain't going to starve, I'll tell you that.
That's right.
We may not drive a Mercedes and a Cadillac, wear a big $1,000, $1,500 suit. But we'll have bread to eat.
Amen.
We'll have bread to give to the people. Amen. In a time of famine. My little boy said on the way down, we were driving, we were talking about the Lord, singing some songs about the Lord. He said, you know, I'm glad to be learning new things about the Lord.
Amen.
Out of the mouth of a 5-year-old boy, I'm glad to be learning new things about the Lord. That's where I thank God to be learning new things about the Lord. Are you still learning some new things? That's the danger of it when we get complacent.
Yes.
And we can't hear the Lord anymore. I'm glad to be learning. Then the Bible says that Elisha says, let's get a big pot, set it on the fire, and we're going to make some pottage for the people to eat. He's going to feed the people. He's, as I said, a type of Christ. He's worried about the spiritual well-being, but he's also worried about the physical well-being. God's worried about both for you. Amen. God ain't going to let you starve. God will see you through. I'm telling you, I'm not a word of faith, money cometh preacher, but I will say that God has blessed my life. Amen. And I've got more now than I started with. And you know, the Lord had let me spend a lot of time praying, God, give me this, or I need this, or I need that. But instead, I walk with the Lord. My faith is in the blood that He shed for me. I've been translated into the kingdom of God's dear Son. And I'm walking in a place where God is allowed to bless me. A lot of people think that financial prosperity means that they're in right relationship with God. That means nothing at all. There's people out there tonight who cuss God and blaspheme His name, but they got more money than they can burn.
Amen.
That just means you're in a nation that has been blessed because others are here. Preaching the gospel. And sadly, in our society, you really don't need God to be wealthy and to be financially stable. But the day is coming, I'm telling you, when the wealth of the people will fail them. The Bible says vain is the help of man. Some trust in horses, some trust in chariots. But we will put our trust in the Lord our God. That cannot be shaken. Everything else will be shaken. I pray like this sometimes. Folks look at me funny. Lord, I pray that everything, every church, every ministry that is not preaching the message of the cross, shut it down. Pull the rug out from under it and lock the door and put a for sale sign behind it. Because you know what it's doing? It's putting poison in the pot.
Come on.
head dragging a pitchfork, pouring poison in the pot. But instead he uses nice, sincere people that carry a Bible, quote a little scripture, and go to church. That's who he uses.
Come on, brother.
The Bible says that he transforms himself as an angel of light.
Amen.
Word transform is an interesting word. It means that the inner nature of the devil, which is deceit, lies, blasphemy, darkness, every wicked thing, has been covered up by a false display on the outside. It means that he looks different on the outside than he truly is on the inside. That is part of the deception. That is his plan.
Come on.
Hallelujah.
The Bible said that they were going to make some pottage, and this one guy goes out. And he gathers up, he finds a wild vine. Oh, this looks good. In a time of famine, a wild vine looks good. I'm going to tell you something. That's who the devil will be. In your time of despair, in a time of testing and trials, the devil will show up and present himself to be exactly what you need at the moment. Like John Collier said, the worst thing is step in when God is breaking somebody down, when God is peeling away the layers of flesh and pride and self-righteousness, when God is breaking somebody down, pray for them, but get away from them. Let God have His perfect work in their life. I went into a preacher's office one time. I got trouble at home. My wife hates me. She hates the way I act. I hate me. I hate the way that I'm doing. I went in there and I cried. I said, man, I'm yoked up with sin. I don't know what to do. You know what he said? He said, don't worry about it. You're saved. Oh, that's the worst advice you could give somebody. Don't worry about it. Oh, you better, if there's a rattlesnake in the aisle right here and he's called up shaking his tail, we just, oh, don't worry about it. No, we're in church. We're in church. Tell you something. He's going to bite somebody.
Yes.
And he's going to kill them. The problem must be identified. But it must, the answer must be given. God has an answer to our problem. If we'd be honest with Him and ourselves tonight, God has an answer to the problem. But you go out here gathering these wild vines. It's a product of the fall. God told Adam, because of his sin, thorns and thistles would the earth produce. There would have been poisonous gourds in that garden.
Come on.
But because of his sin, fallen man has produced these gourds. And they go out and they get them to put them in. They go out to get them to put them in the pottage. And the man, I have no doubt, as I said, he's sincere. He wants to help. We're starving to death. We ain't got nothing else to put in that pot. Let's use this. Looks like a good idea at the time. Let's go along with it. But the problem is a man of the flesh, carnal, and absent from the Spirit of God. He's got no part, no lot in the matter of helping God's people, bringing spiritual aid and strength into the people. What was produced in the fall was a sin nature.
Amen.
It was the seed of the serpent was planted in Adam. The Bible tells us that God said first, He said, let us create man in our image.
That's right.
And when Adam was in the garden with God, God could see mirrored within Adam the likeness of Himself.
Amen.
Righteousness, holiness, purity, everything. He was clothed with the glory and the wonder, the splendor of God. He was created in the image of God. He had no sin nature. He had no evil thought. He didn't even know that he was naked. He had no evil thoughts. But when he sinned, Adam fell from a state of total God consciousness to a place of total self consciousness.
That's right.
Amen.
And his eyes were open. He began to see good and evil. He began to have a sin nature. He tried to cover it up, and God cast him and his wife Eve out of the garden and put a cherubim with a flaming sword at the gate that said, your kind cannot come back in to my presence. And then the Bible said that Adam knew his wife Eve. And she conceived and brought forth a son in the likeness of his father,
yes,
Adam.
Amen.
The world will tell you that we're all God. God's children.
Right.
The Bible says in Galatians chapter 4 that we're children of God by faith in Jesus Christ. We're not all God's children.
Amen.
Jesus said in John 8:44 to a bunch of religious people, He said, "You are of your father the devil, and the works of your father you will do." That's what was produced in the fall. These rotten gores, these rotten, sinful humanity that's trying to help the problem of man. He's not going to help it. He's not going to make it better. But the Bible tells us in 1 Peter 1:23 that when you were born again, it was not of the corruptible seed, but of the incorruptible seed, which is the Word of God that liveth and abideth forever. When you got saved, you got a new seed.
Yes.
The seed of the woman that bruised the head of the serpent
Hallelujah.
Was planted in your
Hallelujah.
Heart. And as that seed sprouts forth roots and produces fruit, you begin to look like Jesus.
Yes.
You begin to act like Jesus. And it's not you, but Christ in you reaching forward to a lost and a dying, helpless humanity. That's when we can help them, because Christ is within us. But I'm telling you something, our sentiments, our good ideas, the wisdom and the programs of man, it's no match for sin. You know what we could all do, and we've all tried it. Clean up the outside.
Come on.
Look a little bit better. I tried that so many times. Do better. I ain't going to do that again. I promise you. Give me another chance. I'll get it right this time. You'll do right for 2 or 3 days. I had a drinking problem. I was 20 years old. I drank every night, and when I thought about it, it scared me. I didn't have some doctor diagnose me with an alcoholic, but I knew that I was, because every time I tried to quit, it drug me right back down. And it'd start off with a couple of beers with supper in the evening time after a hard day's work. And the things would progress, and I'd end up with God knows who and God knows where doing God knows what. I couldn't help it. I couldn't change it, no matter how hard I tried. But one word from the Master. Jesus Christ.
Amen.
I'm telling you, He's the answer. He don't just have the answer, but He is the answer. Oh, hallelujah. He's willing to help us tonight. It's one of their own men that goes out to get the gourds. Jesus said in Matthew 16, He said, "Upon this rock I'm going to build my church, and the gates of hell, the authority of hell itself, can't prevail against my church." Hell can attack the church. The world can attack. They've been doing so for ever since there was a church. The world hates the church. The devil hates the church. But God still has a church, because the gates of hell cannot destroy God's church.
Hallelujah.
From the outside, it cannot be destroyed. But from the inside,
come on,
the church can be polluted.
Amen. That's good.
The gospel's only powerful in its purity.
That's right. Right.
But if we produce a mixture and intertwine it with some of our ideas,
come on,
some of our good intentions, we dilute it and we pollute it, and we come up with what God calls another gospel.
Amen.
And with it comes another Jesus, and with Him comes another spirit, one who's not sufficient to change anything but the outside of men. And He gives the church an appearance, a form of godliness, but it denies the power. It has no dunamis power, no miracle working power of God, because it's another gospel and can't help anybody. The Bible says in Acts chapter 20, verse 29 and 30, Paul warns that church at Ephesus. I'll tell you something about warning. You know, when Paul wrote the letter to the Ephesian church, there's no real rebuke in the letter.
That's right.
He's not straightening out a big issue. You may tell you why. Because the men of God spent 3.5 years warning day and night with tears. He warned that church. It was built upon the foundation of Christ and crucified. But that message also came with a warning. And Paul told the church, he said, "Grievous wolves will enter in among you, and they will not spare the flock." He said, "Of your own selves shall men arise, and they'll speak perverse things to draw away disciples unto himself." The devil wants to get in the church to destroy the church. Jude said in Jude verse 4, he said that false brethren crept in unawares, and they turned the grace of God into lasciviousness. That's already happened. And it's going to continue to happen. The church can be destroyed from the inside. We don't need to look at each other. We don't need to go in on a witch hunt every Sunday morning looking at one another. But what we need to do is examine ourselves to see whether or not we're in the faith. Don't worry about your neighbor as much as you worry about yourself. This guy thought he was helping matters, helping things. But he goes out and he gathers these gourds whom the Bible says that he knew not. Multitudes following Jesus, whom they know not. A man that I read behind me, Brother Gordon Watt, he wrote a book in 1923. One thing that he said then, almost 100 years ago, he said, if there ever was a time, it's now, that we need clear definitions in the church. It's time that we define the Lamb and the Lord that we're following. You know, everybody says we do a lot of street ministry. Everybody says that they know Jesus, that they trust Jesus, that they met the Lord Jesus. But which one is it? There's more than one. And one scripture that I love very much is 1 John chapter 5 and verse 6. John, the beloved, describes Jesus. He says, this is he that came by water and by blood. Not by water only, but by water and by blood. That is the Jesus that you must follow. Amen. That is the Jesus that you must know. It says that the man didn't know the gourds. It means that he hadn't learned of them. Remember when Saul clothed David in his own armor, and David said, I can't go in these because I haven't proved them. I haven't used these. I'm not skilled. I don't have any experience with these. So he took it off and he used what he did know, the sling and the stone that God had equipped him with. The word know in the New Testament is the word gnosko. Yeah. And it means to know by way of experience. Amen. Christianity is not a prayer with a preacher in a baptismal service. Christianity is a spiritual experience with the Lord Jesus Christ. That you know Him by way of experience.
Amen.
And Jesus said in Matthew chapter 7 and verse 22 and 23, He said that many will come unto me in that day saying, Lord, Lord, didn't I do mighty works in your name and cast out devils? Didn't I prophesy in your name? And he said that he would reply to those people, depart from me, I never knew you, you who work iniquity. It means that I never had an experience with you. That's what it means to know the Lord, to enter in to the experience of his death, his burial, and his resurrection. Do you have a testimony tonight that the old man is dead and a new life stands here today to serve testimony that I do know Jesus?
Yes, Lord.
And the cry of my heart is still that I may know him.
Oh, hallelujah.
That I may know him. Oh, it's not enough to admit him 20 years ago. I need to know him today.
Yes.
I want to know him in a deeper way. I want to walk a closer walk with him, a closer walk.
Yes.
Hallelujah. With Jesus. I believe that this pot here can also represent your life. If you go out into the world and put a bunch of stuff in your pot, there's going to be death in the pot. There's going to be poison. The Bible says that your temple, if you're a Christian, your temple is, your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost. He bought you. The Bible says in Ephesians 2 that you've been made the habitation of God by the Spirit. It means that God lives in you. God wants to dwell within you to work His will, His power, His grace, His purpose in your life. But if we go out there in the world and we fill it up with the world stuff, we're poisoning the vessel of God. It says things that they knew not. You know, I think about things that people put in their bodies. Alcohol and drugs. A sexual lifestyle that's outside of God's plan of marriage, you're poisoning your pot.
Amen.
And if you look at what it's brought you, alcohol never helped nobody.
Come on, brother.
In their life, but instead it's destroyed many lives.
Amen.
There's a lot of people, as I said earlier, they're in the cemetery tonight. Mm-hmm. And if they could have one cry, they wish that they could come back and have one day, Lord, And with everything that was in them, they turned from that and turned into the Lord Jesus Christ. Drugs destroy your life. They offer a temporary escape from reality. But the truth is, when you come back down to reality, you'll be lower then than you ever were before. The world paints a picture of sex outside of marriage, outside of God's plan. It looks fine. Nobody's getting hurt, but they don't show you 50 million dead babies who've been aborted and killed all because the world says that it's just fun and games. No, it's poison in your pot. But if that's you tonight, it's not too late for you. Turn to the Lord Jesus Christ. He has an answer. He has a freedom. And He has a hope.
Thank you, Jesus.
He has a hope. Man says that there's death in the pot. They try to eat it. There's death in the pot. It's a bad taste. It's full of poison. It's no good. It's unfit to eat. And that's been brought on by these false, by these wild vines.
That's right.
That's what false doctrine will produce.
Yes. Amen. That's right.
That's good preaching.
Produces something that you cannot eat. Jesus said that my blood is drink indeed.
Yes.
My flesh is meat indeed.
Yes.
Jesus said that unless you eat the flesh and drink the blood of the Son of Man, you have no life in you. He said your fathers ate manna in the wilderness and they're dead now. But whosoever will eat the flesh of the Son of Man shall not die, but have everlasting life. Hallelujah. But everything outside of that is putting death in the pot. Man speaks up and says there's death in the pot.
Right.
You know, it's one thing to identify the problem, brother.
That's right. That's right.
But it's another thing to recognize the answer.
That's right.
And to know the answer. We got plenty of people that won't talk about what's wrong.
That's right.
That's right.
That's all they won't talk about.
That's right.
What's wrong. They won't point out what's wrong with everything that everybody does. But unless we recognize the truth of Jesus Christ in the Scriptures, we can't help anybody by just pointing out what is wrong.
Amen.
I found that in the church there's usually three types of people. You got people that love the Lord. They've got a burden for the lost, and then they're in efforts to reach the lost and to serve God with everything that they have. But on the other side, second group, you have the criticizers and the correctors that hate everything.
Come on.
And they hate everybody. But yet they do nothing to try to help or to reach anybody. All they do is spew out poison, talk about what's wrong with everybody else without trying to get the mold out of their own eye.
Yes.
Amen.
Then you have another group of people who just flat don't care. Don't care if they go to hell. Don't care what Joel Osteen does. Don't care what Jimmy Swaggart does. Doesn't matter to me. I question the salvation of these people. But there's one man in the land who's got an answer to the problem. His name is Elisha. There again, I believe that Elisha is a type of the Lord Jesus Christ. Got a whole lot of prophets, Brother Mark.
That's right, brother.
They were eating poison pottage.
Yes.
But there's one man. Oh, thou man of God. There's death in the pot. This man. Bible says in 1 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 5 that there is one God.
Yes.
And one mediator between God and man.
Yes.
The man, Christ Jesus. And only Jesus Christ has the answer for a lost, a sick, amen, in a dying world. And he speaks up and he says, bring me the meal.
Right.
Bring me the meal and let's put the meal in the pot. The meal, I believe, it represents the whole counsel of God. You know, running rampant through the church is this one-sided theology. Like a car with one big heavy person sitting on one side. It's just teeter-totting. The tires on the right side never get worn out because it's just one-sided. That's the way a lot of churches are. All they talk about is the love of God. He just loves you.
Amen.
He's just tickled to death. Nobody can be saved in that. If that's all we talk about is God's love.
Amen.
On the other side, we have people that they only want to blast people to hell with a machine. You're all going to hell. God has damned you and cursed you. It's wickedness. You're all a bunch of sinners. There's no hope for you. You're all going to hell. There it is, leaning the other way. No, preach the whole counsel of God. God loves you. Oh, God loves you so much that He went to the cross. and shed his blood to bring you life, to bring you freedom, and to bring you salvation.
Hallelujah.
But on the other side, there is a hell.
That's right.
Hell's still real, even in the 21st century.
That's right.
Fire and brimstone. For those who reject God's Son.
That's right.
Not for those who weren't perfect, but for those who reject God's provision.
Good praise.
That's right.
We recognize that there's death in the pot. It's messed up. Nobody can eat of it. There's a famine in the land. What we thought was a good thing turned out to be a bad thing.
Yes.
There's a lot of preachers who we used to think were a good thing.
Come on.
We thought they were very sincere, but once we came into the knowledge of the truth, we realized that what was once a good thing was really a bad thing.
Yes.
And all the trouble that was in my life is partially blamed at the preachers who lied to me. Who cheated me out. But he says, let's bring the meal. The whole counsel of God. Let's pour it in there. Sometimes it might get a little hot in the sanctuary, and you may just need to curl your toes up a little bit. Sometimes a preacher says something to you that you may just need to let it fly over your shoulder and hit your neighbor. But I'm going to tell you something. He does have a bunch of blood. The Bible says that God has chosen the foolishness of preaching to save those that believe. A man that will get up here and make a fool out of himself in the world's eyes.
Glory to God.
Because he loves you.
Praise God.
He cares about whether you make it. That's why he says the things that he does. If you got a pastor that preaches the message of the cross, he preaches the whole counsel of God. This is a sin-sick world and the pot is ours. But be a part of a place that's pouring meal into the pot. Also, this meal, I believe it represents the Word of God in the context of the cross.
Amen.
You know, it's one thing to know the Scriptures. You know, I used to know some Scriptures. But I couldn't make them stick for nothing. I memorized a few of them. Write some on my hand, stick it in my hand, on a piece of paper, and try to memorize it. But the problem with me was it couldn't stick. I tried to do all this stuff. But understand tonight that the cross is the application of the Word of God. Outside of the cross of Calvary, it's just a bunch of words that we've memorized. If you read the story, it appears that the meal was there the whole time.
Amen.
The meal is the Word of God. It's been there the whole time. Even when you were a backslidden preacher, when you were running from God, when you didn't know which way to turn, the meal was there the whole time. But there was nobody to pour it in. But then Elisha stands up and says, bring me the meal. Jesus Christ says, bring me the meal. And he poured it into the pot. And there was no harm left in the pot. Jesus can apply the Word of God. The cross of Christ makes me a candidate to be filled with the Word of God, so the Word of God can be applied. So that the Word of God can be applied, hallelujah, unto my life. The Word of God in context of the cross. The cross is the application of the Word of God. The cross makes me a part of God's family. To Him, the Word of God cannot be applied to Adam. It will not stick.
Right.
No matter how much he wrote it, he talks about it, how much he studies it, he's not a candidate.
Come on.
But when Adam's buried, and the new creature in Christ is raised up, the Bible says in Colossians chapter 1 and verse 12, it says, thanks be to God who has made us meet to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in light.
Amen.
God the Father has made us meet to be partakers. It means that He made us qualified.
Amen.
To be a partaker of the inheritance of the saints in light. You got qualified in Calvary. Calvary is the qualifier. When the Bible says in Colossians 1:13, the next verse, that He translated you from the kingdom of darkness and translated you into the kingdom of His dear Son. And when you've been brought into the new kingdom of God's dear Son, Jesus, now you're a candidate for the Word of God.
Amen.
Now I'm like David. It's a light to my path. It's been applied. Hallelujah. Now it sticks. Now it fits like a glove because I'm a new creature. creature who's been created in true righteousness and true holiness. Only Jesus can do that.
That's right.
Just as only, there's a lot of prophets there.
Amen.
With two arms and two legs. Why didn't they pour the meal in?
That's right, brother.
This man is a type of Christ.
Yes. Amen.
This man, when he made one sacrifice of himself, he sat down at the right hand of God forever. Hallelujah. He's different. The people said of him in that day, there never was a man that spoke like this man.
Yes, yes.
He's not a scribe because he speaks of one who has authority.
Amen.
He said in Matthew 28 that all power and authority has been given in heaven and earth. It's been given unto me. That is who Jesus is.
Amen.
Message of the cross, when it's put into the pot, now we have something to feed the people.
Yes.
Lord, we encourage you, preachers, tonight. Keep your hands on the plow.
Yes.
When that famine hits, they're going to come looking.
That's right.
I told you I was a cowboy. You know what cows do when the grass runs out in the pasture? They start getting out on the side of the road. They start looking for something to eat. Right now, the world is satisfied in apathy, lukewarmness, conceited, and comfortable in their sin. But when all that runs out, when the shaking comes that I'm talking about, they're going to get out and start looking around. Oh, let's be in the church house, but a man put meal in that pot, stirring it around, hallelujah, so that we have something to feed the people when they come. Have something to feed them when they... We ain't got three steps to victory. We got one step. God has one way. Hallelujah. The Lord Jesus Christ.
Hallelujah.
And don't be moved away from
it. Glory to God.
Somebody said that the way is straight and the gate is straight and the way is narrow.
Amen.
I looked that up a couple weeks ago. I was preaching a message. The word straight, the gate actually means narrow.
Narrow.
It's a small gate.
Amen.
A lot of people think it starts out wide. It gets narrow and down there. No, it starts out narrow. That's why you've got to be narrow-minded. Jesus said, many will seek to enter in, but they won't be able to. You know why? They're trying to pull all this other jerk in there with them, but it will not fit. God, don't let you on His way with all that other stuff. Let it go.
Yes, sir.
Let it go. Bible, David said, I'd rather be a doorkeeper in the house of God than to dwell in the tents of the Lord.
Glory to God.
Then it says that the way is narrow. The word narrow means to press.
Amen.
There's pressure on this way.
That's right.
Trying to shove you off of it.
That's right.
To move you away from it. As a young man following the Lord, I can say that there is a pressing. But the Apostle Paul said he pressed.
Amen.
There's a lot pressing against me, but I'm pressing for it. I'm pressing on for the mark of the prize of the high calling of God that is in Christ Jesus. Hallelujah. Let's press on.
Yes.
Let's press on, the saints of God. Then the Bible says in verse 41, he said he'd bring the meal, and he cast the meal into the pot. And he said, pour out for the people that they may eat. For there was no harm in the pot. Jesus took the poison out of the pot. I thank God that He's healing His church. And I thank God that He's still healing bodies. You know what the church is? This church, physical building, got healed. It used to be a Jehovah's Witness building. But the church is really not a building.
That's right.
The church is made up of people.
Right.
Whom their temple has been healed.
Amen.
Their pot, if you will, has been healed by the meal, by the word of God. Every one of us were just like that man on the road to Jericho, cast aside, wounded and dying, bleeding, till the Good Samaritan showed up. Jesus is the Good Samaritan.
Right.
He showed up and He helped us out. We were sick in sin, dead in trespasses and sin. But Jesus came and He poured the meal in.
Amen.
And He raised us up to be, hallelujah, a new creature. I thought of Moses. When they came upon the bitter waters of Marah, the Bible says that the waters were poison and bitter and they couldn't drink it. And the Bible says that Moses cried out to the Lord, and the Lord showed him a tree.
Amen.
And he cast the tree down and cast it into the bitter waters, and the waters were made sweet for the people to drink. That tree is a type of the cross. This meal is a type of the cross. A few chapters before, Elijah put put salt into the water. And he said, I have healed these waters. All throughout the scriptures, God is desperately trying to get you to see that there's one cure to the same old situation of sin, and that is Jesus Christ and the cross that he died on.
Yes.
And that's what he's calling us to today. Yeah, I don't know who you are. I imagine all of you love God. You're in church on a Saturday night.
Amen.
But I do know along this way, while we're pressing,
amen,
we can get wounded. Hallelujah. And we can get bruised. And our life can turn a little sour.
Yes.
I want you to know that Jesus is in the house.
Amen.
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 And he loves you.
Amen.
And he just wants you to sit at his feet. Maybe a time of famine. You may be going through a breaking process in your life. Let's just sit at his feet.
Yes.
Listen to him. Let's hear his heartbeat tonight. Let's seek the Lord. Let's seek him for this meal. That is our only answer. The Word of God applied in the context of Christ and the cross. Let's seek God for an understanding of his Word. Let's seek the Lord for a restoration and a revival in our land.